Let's move now to the next, which is we're going to move into the inputs. And the inputs are what we generally think about in terms of the actions that we can take to really drive those four metrics that we just reviewed. So the governor likes to talk about value for money as the phrase that he's used, and it's a good phrase that really captures really what all of us do when we go into the store, right? When we go into Meijer, we're looking for, you know, what's the value of the product we get for the price that we pay? And the beauty is you want to try and get the highest value for the money in what you buy. That's no different than it is for business. They want to get a really good product for what the cost is. And so let's take a look at the next slide, which shows first on cost. So on the left side, cost of doing business, right side, the labor costs in particular. Mark, Rick, I guess, how do you think Michigan is positioned on those factors in your view?
Well, again, remember we started off with these benchmarks are trailing indicators. So what we have to keep in mind is the changes that are going on today are not going to show up for a while. And these numbers go back to 2008, so they're even a little bit older. So you can't look at this chart and tell what's going on today. It's no different than if you're designing a complex product for business and it takes you multiple years of R&D and then you got to take it to the marketplace. The upfront investment, you're not going to know if you're getting a return on that for a long period of time. The changes that we're making today aren't going to show up in these metrics for a couple years until we'll really know whether or not we've got traction, we're making forward progress. These numbers show us to be in an uncompetitive position, and I think that's kind of the mindset we have to have, is that we have to keep working on a number of initiatives to try to keep making sure, as Ron said, that the selection criteria that we're in the positive category on a lot of the different variables, not just one or two.
And I just, the only thing I'd add is to keep reminding ourselves, average probably isn't good enough. This is a very competitive situation. It is a globally competitive challenge in terms of where new capital will be deployed. And so that's why, as a group, we keep talking about being a top 10 state. And the actual index number here is compared to the U.S. average. It would be a poorer index number, a little higher in that way the index scale works, if we were comparing it just to the top 10, because the top 10 is well below the national average.
So let's go to the next slide, which I think gets at this a little bit more. This slide specifically looks at taxes on business relative to individuals, recognizing there's a lag here and that this does not reflect the recent tax changes that were made here in the state, but it does show the general favorable position of Michigan as a state to live in for individuals versus the heavier burden traditionally that Michigan has had on businesses. Mark, what's your sense of the changes that were made this year, how much that's going to help, and maybe de-skewing some of these numbers?
I'm confident they will help. I want to be careful. I don't think it would be fair to take this picture, put our changes in, and assume every other state's going to say the same.
Right.
This is a perpetually changing landscape, and others will continue to make changes as well. Ron had the story about what was going on in Ohio. They've made changes. Well, we're now competing with a different Ohio than we were competing with 4 or 5 years ago, and that is what just keeps going on. There has been significant action in both corporate tax and unemployment insurance. And so, again, I would expect that there would be some significant improvement, but we'll see as we go on. I think the individual taxes, what you have seen in a lot of states, is moving much more heavily into the sales tax than Michigan has, and that's why we're ranked so well there. But property taxes have not been made changes. I think the governor and some of the legislative leaders have said they want to get at that personal income tax, personal property tax. Personal property tax really means machinery and equipment property tax, and that's an area where the state historically has not been particularly competitive with other states either.
Rick, any other thoughts?
The only comment I make is that taxes, I like taking business taxes as a group because we do have work left to do on the property taxes to see where we're going to move to. I think from what we've seen to date and the analysis that we've had done, this will improve us, but it won't take us to be a top 10 state. So we may have some more work to do, and it may be in the property tax arena. And again, taxes are only just one criteria for economic development. There are others that we have to start working on also.
Let's go to the next slide. So oftentimes one thing that's been used are incentives to try to compensate for a high tax burden. Michigan has historically ranked pretty high in terms of the types of incentives and availability of those incentives. We know they're changing dramatically. Governors basically ended tax credits as we know them and shifted that over to an appropriation model where there's going to be a pot of money at the MEDC that they can use for putting together individual projects. Rick, how do you think this, I guess the incentives landscape, this shift in an incentive strategy in Michigan, is this going to hurt our competitiveness, or do you think it's, how does that play relative to the tax changes we just talked about?
Well, philosophically, I kind of agree with the change, but you have to look at it this way. We're trying to market the state of Michigan. So if we had strengths in our core competencies, then we wouldn't have to necessarily use the incentives. I think Ron spoke to that. To go and take away the incentives without having improved the other areas, I don't know how we're going to make ourselves competitive when we try to sell organizations to move and come to our state. It should be, you have to be improving one while you take the other down. The cliff approach is going to be difficult. So what we're going to have to sell then is the future of Michigan. And I think that's going to be a difficult sale without, you know, a track record of having shown dramatic improvements in a lot of areas.
And I think if the question is choose between where we were and where we are, I would take where we are, which is a lower overall business tax climate and fewer incentives. I think we'll need some vigilance and see if there is deal flow that looks like we could have had it if we'd either held on to or we adjusted some of the ways we're doing incentives now. But I think we're in a better spot than we were in before. The sectors that it will grow, it always are the generators, typically more in the small business sector, a little harder for people to know where to target those resources. And then sometimes in sectors that you just wouldn't expect. I mean, one of the great sources of wealth and philanthropy and generosity in West Michigan has been the team that put the Amway company together. I just don't remember a time when somebody got all excited about incentives for direct selling soap companies. That just isn't typically a target industry. You know, some of that fabulous rebuilding of the city of Detroit, that the just enormous generosity of the Illiches, I'm not sure I've ever seen anybody target the pizza industry. And so sometimes there's these industries just grow up. Entrepreneurs are the source of the vitality, and I think sometimes they occur in sectors we're not entirely able to predict in advance. So I don't diminish incentives. Certainly, as state treasurer and state budget director, I was involved on the board of the Omega and working with Doug over when he was in MEDC, and it was very clear there were some deals that wouldn't have come to the state if we hadn't had some incentives there. So I don't mean to diminish them, but I would certainly take where we are right now.
We talk a little bit about costs. Let's go to kind of what's the value for the costs that you get in Michigan. Go to the next slide and talk specifically about talent, about education. We know that Michigan does well in terms of conferring degrees, relatively high ranking, but we know we have kind of this little bit of Achilles heel that we don't have as large a percentage of individuals with at least a bachelor's degree or above in the workforce. Rick, how's the talent landscape look when you look at numbers like this in Michigan?
I think it's the same thing we're seeing in a lot of different areas. Michigan is very highly rated in terms of the number of degreed candidates it puts out. Yet we're unable to retain them in Michigan because the economic environment is weak and the jobs for those people to have are not there. So they're leaving our state, they're going elsewhere. So we've got the engine, but we're not taking advantage of the engine. So what we have to do is we have to change not only the outputs, and we have to improve job growth. We have to change the perception of opportunity, too. And Ron talked about perception. That's all important. These young people have to have the belief that this is a great place to stay, a great place to build their careers, and then we have to follow that up with the necessary jobs for them to get a foothold and get started.
And let's go to the next slide, because I'll throw this one to Mark. I mean, clearly one of the strengths of Michigan is our research and development base, mm-hmm. both for universities and clearly for industry. Mark, what's your sense of looking at the talent equation and then combining it with the research and development strength? Where is Michigan at, I guess, in really leveraging this as an economic driver?
I think this is our great opportunity. And we have had a little bit of a big organization culture. There, lots of big companies have grown up, and big institutions. We've got more of a big university system than we've got a lot of small colleges, although we certainly have some outstanding small colleges. But it's big. It's bigness, and we've often not had the underlying infrastructure as much as we need for the capitalization of some of this R&D into new business opportunity. What they're doing in Kalamazoo right now is absolutely spectacular, of taking the talent they have, getting the financial underpinnings, and getting a whole set of new small businesses starting up that interweave to really help in pharmaceutical development. And I think that's the trend we're going to be seeing, because it's working there, it's going to work in other communities. And I think building off this is a global world. It is a globally competitive world, and R&D is absolutely one of our strengths, and there's no reason at all why we can't see the continued spin-off and development of new businesses out of this great R&D work.
So let's go to the next slide, if we could. Another value you get for Michigan is the entrepreneurial environment. We've seen a gradual rise in venture capital investment in the state. We used to rank down in the 40s mm-hmm. not too long ago, kind of middle of the pack now. Probably still not a hotbed for venture capital, but a lot better. We also see the entrepreneurial activity index. What that is really a measure of how many of the startups that get going really are able to convert into long-term viable businesses. And we see that ranking is pretty middle of the pack, maybe a little below average. What Rick, what can we do, in your view, do you think, to maybe kind of get these numbers up higher? Or what does this mean even for established companies, the entrepreneurial vitality of the state?
Well, I think Mark said it. I mean, this is really a great opportunity for Michigan. It's one of our core strengths. So. A lot of the R&D is in private industry, and it's kind of proprietary. We have to change that model a little bit. We have to find areas where innovation and entrepreneurial activity can take the R&D out of our universities and bring other R&D operations in. And then we have to match up the capital to keep it here in Michigan. All the R&D projects out of our universities, they're being capitalized. They're just being capitalized in other states. We have to figure out how we can get those to stay here, grow here, and there's a lot of good ideas to do that. You know, we need incubators, things like that, where we can get businesses started and let them stay in the state and develop and grow their businesses here.
Mark, any other thoughts?
Well, I keep a line in my head, which is why complain when we can act? And the question is, what do we get to do? What do we do today? What do we do tomorrow? Everybody's got some influence in some domain. And you've all come here because you care about the great state of Michigan. There's something going on entrepreneurial in your area, in your geography, in your industry, in your sector. And how do we get those stories up and encourage others to take the risk? It's an enormous risk to venture out and start it up. And that can be a little bit of a foolish risk, or that can be a heroic risk. And to some degree, it's the people around the entrepreneur that apply that adjective. And I think we've got the opportunity to really warm up and understand the heroism of the risk-taking that the entrepreneurial class undertakes really every day. And there's hundreds of ways we can be encouraging to that. That's culture work. That's not really program work. But we're also, as leaders, have some responsibility around the culture.